Hi, everyone.
And welcome to our story. Let me tell you a Bible verse. Psalm 19, 1 through 2 says, "The heavens are singing about how great God is, and the skies are shouting it out. See what God has made. God wrote, 'I love you.' He wrote it in the sky and on the earth and under the sea. He wrote his message everywhere."
And God put it into words, too. He wrote it in a book called the Bible. Now, some people think the Bible is a book of rules, telling you what you should and shouldn't do. The Bible does have rules in it. They show you how life works best.
But the Bible isn't mainly about you and what you should be doing. It's about God and what He has done.
Other people think the Bible is a book about heroes, showing you people you should copy. The Bible does have some heroes in it, but as you'll soon find out, most of the people in the Bible aren't heroes at all. They make some big mistakes. They get afraid and they run away. And at times, they're downright mean.
No, the Bible isn't a book of rules or a book of heroes. The Bible is most of all a story. It's an adventure story about a young hero who comes from a far country to win back his lost treasure. It's a love story about a brave prince who leaves his palace, his throne, everything to rescue the one he loves.
It takes the whole Bible to tell this story. And at the center of the story, there is a person named Jesus. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. He is like the missing piece in a puzzle, the piece that makes all the other pieces fit together. And suddenly, you can see this beautiful picture, and this is no ordinary person. This is the person upon whom everything would depend. This is the person who would one day—
Wait! Our story starts where all good stories start, right at the very beginning. A very long time ago, right here in this world, there was a garden. In the garden, everything was wonderful. The world was full of laughing and playing and smiling and fun. There's nothing bad, ever. There's no one sad, ever. And best of all, God was there. He made it all. He was in charge of it all. He loved it all. People could see God and speak to God and just enjoy being with God.
It was wonderful to live with God. But then one day, the people did a terrible thing. They decided they didn't want to do what God said. They decided they wanted a world without God in charge. God calls this sin. Sin spoils things. So sin had no place in God's wonderful garden. God had to put them outside the garden, and He told them, "Because of your sin, you can't come in."
Years later, God wanted His people to remember that it's wonderful to live with Him, but because of your sin, you can't come in. So He told the people to build a special building called His temple where He would live. In the middle of the temple was the most wonderful place in the world. The place where God was, with nothing bad and nothing sad. It was very exciting. But then God told people to put a big curtain around the wonderful place. It was a big keep out sign. Hundreds of summers and winters passed by, and the keep-out curtain stayed in the temple.
Then one day, God's Son came to live in this world as a person. He was called Jesus. Jesus always did what God said. Jesus never sinned. Jesus said that God had sent Him to open the way back to God's wonderful place, where there would be nothing bad and no one sad.
When Jesus and His disciples headed to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, a huge crowd came out, When Jesus and His disciples headed to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, a huge crowd came out, lying out their coats and palms. When Jesus and His disciples headed to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, a huge crowd came out, laying out their coats and palm branches, shouting, "Hosanna!"
Sydney, do that again.
When Jesus and His disciples head to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, a huge crowd came out, laying out their coats and palm branches, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David!" It sounds like the crowd knows Jesus is the Messiah, the promised Savior, the one who will rescue the people forever.
But it also sounds like they think he's going to be a king, just like the kings of the past. They didn't understand about this new kind of kingdom. Before Adam and Eve sinned, God reigned on earth, and Adam and Eve reigned with him as children of the king. They were never hungry, they were never sick, they never had to worry about death because they lived in God's kingdom, the way things are supposed to be. But sin ruined that. So Jesus shows up and announces that the kingdom of God is back. Then he gives everyone a taste of what that kingdom is like through his miracles. There will be no hunger. Bam! He feeds 5,000 people just like that. There will be no sickness. Boom! He heals people. The crippled, the blind, whatever is broken about us is fixed the way it was supposed to be. He calms the wild sea and even raises people from the dead to show in this kingdom of God, there is nothing to fear, not even death itself.
What about sin? Our sin can't be with God. How can we reign with him in this new kingdom if we can't be with him?
That's a great question. Well, Jesus was killed. He was crucified by being nailed to a wooden cross. As Jesus is dying, he looks up to heaven saying, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Suddenly, the sky grows dark and Jesus dies. The curtain of the temple rips from top to bottom. This is the most amazing part. The people around Jesus just saw a man dying on a cross, but that's not what God saw. God saw something very different happening. He saw his son, the Son of God, on a cross. Then he saw the stain of our sin appearing on Jesus. Your sin, my sin, everything selfish or mean we've ever done or ever could do. The stain of all that sin was appearing on Jesus. Even though he'd never done anything wrong at all, God saw his son stained with all the sin of the world. He saw him buried under all that sin. He saw him die under all that sin. And since the punishment for sin is death, death away from God, that's how Jesus died, alone, away from God. The last thing Jesus said was, "God, why have you left me alone?"
But if he died, how can we say that Jesus has power over death?
Because he didn't stay dead. Jesus was crucified on a Friday and placed in a tomb that night. On Sunday morning, two women who were followers of Jesus went to the tomb and saw something incredible. It was empty. The huge stone that blocked the entrance had been rolled away and Jesus wasn't there. Matthew and Luke both tell us that the two women met an angel who says Jesus is no longer dead. He's alive. They didn't have to take the angel's word for it though, because Jesus appears right in front of them, living, walking around and talking. And then Jesus appears to his disciples and then to more than 500 people.
Jesus proved that the power of sin and death was broken.
Then, according to Luke, Jesus blesses his disciples and disappears into the clouds.
Heaven would not lose. Jesus left the tomb with our freedom from sin in hand. The brave prince offered his whole life to rescue the ones he loves. The natural response to such a victory is, "Hooray for God and Jesus! We can be a part of his new kingdom and reign with him."
Jesus doesn't make us follow him. He invites us to follow him. To be a part of the new kingdom, to experience life as a child of the king. But like any invitation, we can say, "No thanks, not interested." For anyone who says yes to Jesus, for anyone who believes what Jesus said, for anyone who will just reach out and take it, then God will give them this wonderful gift.
Because you see, the most wonderful thing about this story is it's your story too.